Tonight is a special night where we are featuring Susan Eisenhower, the granddaughter of the 34th President of the United States of America and a five-star general. I well recall on March the 28th, 1969, when our principal came on the loudspeaker and declared that President Eisenhower had died and the flags will be lowered to half-mast. Later, at a cemetery near Calais, France, I observed crosses and stars of David in all four directions, thousands of them. And at that point, I realized what an outstanding leader Dwight Eisenhower was. Susan's father, John Eisenhower, was also a general and was the author of a number of books. As a military person and as a historian, he offered very unique insights into American military history. Susan is the author of three books, and she has edited a number of books. I well recall when Stephen Ambrose gave a speech and said that Dwight Eisenhower had only two documented lies in his entire career. One was to Adolf Hitler, and the other one was to Nikita Khrushchev, and the crowd roared with laughter. It is an honor to introduce Susan Eisenhower, the author of How Ike Led.
Well, thank you very much. It's an absolute pleasure to be here at the Allen Public Library. And I want to say special thanks to Mr. Keener for making this event possible. It's so nice to think of how close you are to Denison, Texas, where my grandfather was born. And I've been down that way myself, and it's really a beautiful, beautiful part of the world. In any case, I thought I would tell you about this book that I started a couple of years ago. And I thought, well, you know, we've got some big events coming up, the 75th anniversary of the end of victory in Europe, and also the 75th anniversary of the end of World War II with the successful surrender of the Japanese. And then we had last week, as a matter of fact, the dedication of the Eisenhower Memorial in the Monumental Corps of Washington, D.C. What a moving event that was. And it was, you know, an experience I'll never forget, both in helping the commission work out the details on the design to actually seeing it come to fruition. But, you know, at the same time, I thought, my grandfather, Dwight Eisenhower, still has something to say to the American people. And I actually decided to sit down and write about Ike's leadership in both wartime and during his presidential years. Now, I know Mr. Keener could tell you that a lot of the scholarship on Dwight Eisenhower revolves around sort of two pillars of his career. So many scholars want to write about the war years, and then another set of scholars are primarily interested in his presidency. But what I've tried to do in this book is to make sure that the reader understands that the wartime Dwight Eisenhower and the presidential Dwight Eisenhower is the same person. It's so interesting for me as I went through the scholarship to understand how many people in one silo or the other did not or were not able actually to see the whole person that I was fortunate to know. Now, I have to say that I had a very strange childhood, and I think all disclaimers are important at this point. I remember having an experience one afternoon with Granddad on the sun porch at the Gettysburg Farm, and my history and civics teacher sent me home with a few questions for Granddad. Well, you know, I have to say he didn't like that very much. He didn't like mixing business and pleasure, and he especially didn't like his grandchildren being put in a position where they would have to use their relationship with him to satisfy somebody's curiosity. So not having a sense that that was going to be a little bit of an issue, I said anyway. And so Mr. Granzow would like to know why you didn't intervene in Hungary, you know, in 1956. And Ike, a little bit annoyed by this, crosses legs and says, "What, and start World War III?" Okay. I thought, wow, start World War III. Were you in a position to start World War III? This was a big, I wouldn't say it was a shock to me, but suddenly I realized that actually my grandfather had made some enormous decisions in his career, that being only one of them. So I had a rather odd childhood, as I mentioned a second ago. I had Secret Service protection for the time he was in office. And then I had glimpses into his official life that I think we were pretty much sheltered from, to the extent that that was possible. And I remember once coming home from school, and I often, this is in Ike's retirement, and I often would stop by his office on the Gettysburg College campus to get a ride home. And one day I was in this back, he had a back office to a larger office where he met his guests and talked on the phone and things, but there was kind of an inner office. And there was this enormous map of the Normandy landings. I think you know that picture. It's probably D-Day plus two when the great ships are now in this, you know, docked up, as it were, to the, you know, parts of the Normandy coast. And then, as you remember, eventually we put in artificial harbors, but an extraordinary picture. And I asked him about that. And with total patience and graciousness, this man walked me through the invasion of Normandy and victory in Europe in sixth grade language. In any case, as I grew up, I developed a very big interest in national security issues after serving first as a journalist. And in those years of national security work, I was actually a policy analyst. And everywhere I went, I could feel his legacy. He was everywhere. There really wasn't anything, including space policy, which I worked on for more than 12 years. I was on the NASA Advisory Council. Even that he founded in 1958. And so I'm grateful to my parents for suitably compartmentalizing their children. I was raised to understand that on the one hand, I had a very special and personal relationship with Dwight Eisenhower. And on the other hand, unless I became a medical doctor, I'd probably run into his legacy somewhere. And I, you know, would have to be prepared for that. Remember in the 1960s, his star had not risen the way it has now. And my siblings and I were often subjected to rude lectures about Eisenhower's shortcomings, and it was pretty tough as a kid in those years. And anyway, I did fully compartmentalize everything until I wrote this book. And I decided that I wasn't going to populate the book with my own views the way I've just told you, but I thought it would be interesting to try and compare the family events that we had underway during those times with the huge decisions he was making. First, I was born after the war, but I should say first as president when I came onto the scene, and then in his retirement. And I think the thing that I found absolutely stunning, and I wasn't surprised, but I had it reinforced, that even in this public life, it was in complete alignment with his private life, in that he never became hard or cynical or pessimistic about the future of this country. I might have thought that even in his diaries, and he was a great diarist, that I might have, in my scholarly research, seen some indications of that, but I really didn't. In fact, I found so many moving passages where he would write his wartime colleagues and talk about the forces of good that are there in the world today, that we shouldn't be pessimistic because we tend to underestimate how many people are working for a better tomorrow. This wasn't a platitude on Eisenhower's part. He really believed that what humankind had been through during World War II was not only looking into the face of evil itself, but that it could never be allowed to happen again, that the catastrophe could not be replicated, because if war broke out again, this time it would be nuclear war, and it wouldn't be atomic weapons. It would be hydrogen weapons that were so very, very much more powerful. And so that's what I liked about putting my own memories together, just as a sort of check on some of the scholars who really, as I said, were just not as lucky as I was to know this man. And I must say, since the book has come out, I am really indebted not only to the exceptional scholarship that's been done, but by the graciousness of that committee. And so let me say that I think you have to go back to Eisenhower's roots to understand the basics of Dwight Eisenhower himself as a personality. As you know, he was born in Denison, Texas, when his father, David Jacob Eisenhower, had been forced to retreat after a business failure. He had opened a shop during the Great Farmland Depression, and lost most of his money, and paid off all of his debts before he came down to work on the railroad in Denison. And after Dwight was born, they eventually, the three sons already on the scene, and my great-grandparents moved back to Abilene, Kansas, where their religious community was located. Dwight Eisenhower was a German-American for sure, almost 100% German, if not 100%. And his parents, or their community, spoke largely German. Ike's father, however, did not want to have his children raised as Germans per se, so they were all taught English. But it was a community that had deep ties to Germany. What a fascinating thing when you think about it, that this man who was, this boy who was raised in this religious German-American community would later defeat Nazi Germany. In any case, the thing that prevailed in that household was an adherence to something larger than themselves. And I think that stayed with him his entire life and merged, of course, with his responsibilities as articulated in his first year at West Point. He himself said that when he took a pledge to defend the Constitution of the United States, that his life would be forever changed, that he would no longer be serving himself, but he would be serving the nation as a whole. You know, these kinds of deeply embedded feelings were things that he carried with him into the White House. A little more on that later. In any case, I mean, Ike's life was not seamless. He had many disappointments early on. He had a bit of a temper. I know for myself that he was a very passionate man. And if you want to read some rather exciting prose, and he was a great writer, his diaries are fun to read because he works out a lot of his problems in his diaries, including making observations about the people he worked with. In one of his diaries, he has a chapter called Notes on Men, where he analyzes all of his superiors and their shortcomings as leaders and their downsides. The interesting thing was is that he wasn't being judgmental. What he was doing was going through this process to decide for himself what qualities he liked and what qualities he wanted to keep. For instance, he said that General Douglas MacArthur was a genius in offering clear instruction, but he certainly didn't want to be like Douglas MacArthur, a man who actually talked in the third person, you know, rather like Queen Victoria. We are not amused, right? Douglas MacArthur also had a temper and at times a capacity to belittle people. So Ike is making these notes in his diaries about what he wants to be and what he doesn't want to be, and how lucky we are for those left behind to have to be privy, actually, to those sets of thoughts and feelings. In any case, at West Point, again in the disappointment department, he was unable to continue a really stunning potential football career. For those of you who are big football fans, Ike played for the Army in a game against Carlisle, and Jim Thorpe was on the Carlisle team. So that's pretty exciting stuff. But he broke his knee along the way and was sidelined from playing football. This was a huge disappointment because he was looking forward so many things now about being in the Army, but certainly football was one of them. You have to be careful what you wish for, because after his West Point graduation, the Army between the wars didn't really imagine that there was going to be another war coming, and we were quite unprepared. But Ike, who already had shown enormous intellectual promise, was being sent around to Army posts all over the United States coaching football. Well, in any case, he first comes to the attention of the Army. And I'm telling you the story, it's not really covered in my book because I didn't know we were going to have a pandemic. But it is interesting to note that in 1919, Eisenhower had already been assigned to be commander of a tank corps in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania. And this was at Camp Colt. Camp Colt started out as a very small unit. Eisenhower was the commander of it, age about 28. And at that time, he started out with about 50 soldiers and next about 500. But by the fall of 1918, he had 10,000 men under his command. And then two individuals came into the camp who had Spanish flu and began, you know, nobody really knew what caused the flu or how it transmitted itself. And these two soldiers ended up infecting large swaths of the camp. Now you can imagine how utterly alarmed the townspeople were in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, because they had 10,000 men right there at Pickett's Charge, where Camp Colt was located. In any case, Dwight Eisenhower not only managed the Spanish flu influenza, he got his tank corps ready to go to the front in France. And so it's a rather remarkable story. He instituted quarantining. Sound familiar? And in the meantime, he is also training these troops to go overseas. It was, as it turned out, to be a masterful exhibition of the leadership we would see later in his career. At the age of 28, 29, he received the Distinguished Service Medal, which is one of the highest awards the United States Army gives. For his performance at Camp Colt. Nevertheless, after that, he went to, of course, to coach football teams, and he also ended up in the Panama Canal Zone with a general named Fox Connor. I will sort of skip over this story a bit just to say that Fox Connor was a remarkable man. He was chief of operations for John Pershing. But Fox Connor really devoted the last part of his life to being mentors to some great up-and-coming individuals in the Army. And how lucky Dwight Eisenhower was to have him as a mentor. Fox Connor understood that this officer had a talent for strategic thinking. And actually, if you jump way ahead, the three jobs that were consequential in Eisenhower's career, Supreme Allied Commander during World War II, the first commander of NATO forces, and then a two-term president of the United States. All three of those jobs were strategic leadership jobs that required not only leadership, but a capacity to think strategically and to be able to moderate and change a plan should that be necessary. That terrible, terrible airborne drop was significant for Dwight Eisenhower for two reasons. He knew good planning when he saw it, and when he was given the command of the cross-channel invasion, he looked at the plan and he said, there's not enough force here. So we're gonna have to add Utah Beach so that the Americans can meet their objectives in Cherbourg. And in order to secure Utah Beach and also a broadened Omaha Beach, it required the paratroopers. So I think it's generally accepted that if Eisenhower hadn't stepped in and said this plan isn't going to succeed, because by this time he'd had a lot of experience with logistics and other military elements, we would have failed on D-Day. As it turned out, the paratroop drop was the linchpin of the entire operation. And Ike's moral courage to go out and look those men in the eyes after he had been given a very dire briefing is something that has always moved me. Well, I think I just need to say very quickly that, you know, a man who bore that responsibility had went from having about 50 people under his under the American command in Europe to more than 3 million Americans under his command, and then as many as 5 million in the space of, well, from 1942 to for 3 years. Now that's scaling up an operation. And obviously after the victory, he was an extraordinarily popular person and was the subject of so much interest from both the Democrats and Republicans that Ike says in his diaries that the attention made him want to dive under his desk. He did not intend to be president of the United States. He did not intend to run because he thought that his responsibilities and his duties might lie somewhere else. But finally, after the Republicans made it clear that they were still isolationists and they wanted America to come home, Dwight Eisenhower took up the mantle of a candidacy and went on to become the 34th president of the United States. There's so many decisions within his presidency that were consequential. I outline them in the book, but I try and bring a kind of humanness to the man I knew. And in some cases, I think it's fair to say that I could add some things to the record that others have not been able to include. Some of that was his kindness. And I say in the beginning of the book, and I mean this sincerely to all of those who are listening, he led with his head, but he also led with his heart. He had an extraordinary understanding of human nature. I don't know where he got it, maybe from his mother, who was an exceptional person. But he studied men and women, and he was a great listener, and he was adept at putting himself in other people's positions. As a matter of fact, that's one of my great memories at the dining room table. It was always, well, how do you think that looks to the other guy, he would say. And this capacity to manage his personal relationships, his political, his military relationships, made it possible for him to build what he called the middle way. This is a political middle way where both sides of any issue can come together in the middle to compose their differences, compromise, and find a way forward to bring America into this modern era, an era that was full of rapid, dramatic technological change, and an era that was just on the cusp of big social change as well. So let me, if I may, just sort of wrap it up there. I have so many things I wanted my readers to know, but I wanted them to know, I think most of all, that he still has something to say to us, as I mentioned earlier. I feel that so passionately because America, I'm sorry, I'm not being political here at all. I don't think I actually even have a political bone in my body. I think I'm with Ike. I want what's best for this country. But our whole nation seems to be lost, and even people who are remarkably polite to one another years ago now are short-tempered. People don't want to be together. Oh my gosh, wait till Thanksgiving comes up this year. I don't know how many are going to find that an easy situation since so many families are even divided. But you know what? Ike had a divided family too. He had an extremely conservative older brother and an extremely liberal younger brother. And there was another moderate in the family. But I think as the third child, Ike was always managing the differences between the elder brother and the younger brother. And he was very adept at understanding that if you are good to people, if you don't insult them, if you make sure that they know that we're all trying to accomplish the same thing, just with different ideas about how to go about it, that a lot of progress could be made. I don't know how aware of you are of the long list of the accomplishments of the Eisenhower administration, but it's really quite stunning. Let me just hit a few high points here. Well, of course, he brought Hawaii and Alaska into the Union. He secured Antarctica for future generations for peaceful purposes only. He, of course, managed the beginning of the Cold War, was the first president to organize. He's the first president of the space age, and also organized all the technological and military responses to that. He balanced the budget three times in 8 years, came very close on another two, and left his successor, John F. Kennedy, with a budget surplus. A budget surplus and balancing the budget three times while he built an interstate highway system and built the St. Lawrence Seaway. So many other things he did. He ended the Korean War. And in his last, I would say in his eight-year terms, after he ended the Korean War, there was not one combat casualty during Eisenhower's tenure. I think it's a remarkable set of achievements. I say that as Susan Eisenhower, the professional. As Susan Eisenhower, a family member, I still have not fully brought all this together in my head. We were taught to be challenged to be as modest about Eisenhower's achievements as he was, because I can tell you that he died as he lived, as a humble man who understood that his country came first, and that there was a higher cause that mobilized him and made it possible for him never to lose sight of what he was trying to accomplish. So, Mr. Keener, I'm wondering if you have some questions for me or anybody in the audience.
First of all, tell us how they can buy one of your books.
Oh, okay. Well, I think it's out there. Of course, local bookstores would love an order from you. If you go to my website, it's www.susaneisenhower.com. You'll obviously see other choices beyond Amazon. And Politics and Prose, which is an independent bookstore in Washington, you can acquire a signed copy through that bookstore. And also, you know, it's on Audible, so you can hear an audio version of this book. And I think that should probably do you. Otherwise, it can be Googled, and I'm sure there are many other suggestions about where to buy it. I tried to make it readable, and I guess the other thing, Mr. Keener, I wanted to say is that, you know, the former journalist in me, as opposed to now the academic and the policy analyst, thought that we have such a big leadership industry in our country, and some of them resort to trying to give formulas for how people can become leaders. And I thought, well, you know, how you become a leader is a very personal thing. Ike did most of the work inside himself. He always put his house in order before he started requiring other people to do it too. And so I thought I would show that instead of telling it, because when you tell something, it lacks the spice and the warmth and other things that come from storytelling. And back to your wonderful comment about my father, he always told me that if you want to convey anything, wrap it in a story, because from time immemorial, human beings have passed stories along, and we know how to assimilate them and how to find meaning in them.
Our first question comes from his grandfather, Franklin Roosevelt, was your grandfather's commander-in-chief. His father, Elliot Roosevelt, was under your grandfather's command during Operation Torch and made vast contributions to that effort. This question comes from Elliot Roosevelt, Jr. I would like to understand President Eisenhower's personal view of some of the early formidable planners of the U.S. World War II effort and strategy who preceded him, more specifically Henry Stimson, George Marshall, Ernest King. Did they lay out the strategy early on that guided the war effort, or were there major strategic shifts as the war progressed?
Well, first of all, I am so thrilled to have a question from such a distinguished person. And I know that Elliot Roosevelt and my grandfather were very good friends. And it's just wonderful to have actually a very pointed and very interesting question. I'm one of the few Washingtonians, by the way, who tries not to speak up on things I don't know that much about. So I have to say that the first part of the question about Eisenhower's personal views about Stimson, Marshall, and King, I have read about that in his diaries. But again, he used diaries as a way to pour out his inner feelings so that he could recalibrate himself to stay calm. He was a very disciplined man. So I certainly know what he thought of those characters. I should say they're not characters, of course. They're characters in a great story, but they were very, very important figures. I do know a lot more about his relationship with George Marshall, and I must say that it was a very correct relationship, a very professional relationship. But I know that my grandfather was devoted to him. And Marshall was a remarkable person for his capacity in understanding the role the delegation plays in gigantic operations like World War II. You can't imagine how a nitpicker or a detail person could have survived that job. Marshall understood that he had to, his subordinates had to be people who could take responsibility for decisions that they themselves made, and he offered a kind of extraordinary strategic leadership framework for them to do that. Admiral King was somebody Ike noted in his diaries as being a rather dramatic character. I think it was Franklin Roosevelt who said that King shaved every morning with a blowtorch. He was an outside personality, and I believe, like just about everybody in the war effort, had a frustration level and a temper, and my grandfather certainly had one too. All of them were trying very hard to do what they thought was right in the context of this enormous challenge, but I know from reading Ike's diaries that he went out of his way to become a friend of Admiral King's, and I think that worked out to America's and well, and to the Alliance's enormous benefit later in the war. So finally, let me just say about the strategy itself. COSAC was the, you might sort of say it was the board of directors of the war. And this is a group, that's the combined chiefs of Great Britain and the United States, and both Alan Brooke from Great Britain and George Marshall sat on this committee. And yes, there was always a kind of tension between the British and the Americans about this cross-channel assault that George Marshall and Dwight Eisenhower advocated. The British actually talked us into North Africa and Sicily while we were preparing to get ready for a cross-channel invasion. But I don't think that the British were ever as enthusiastic about the D-Day landings as the Americans were in terms of making changes. But actually, you can understand why, I should say, because the vast majority of the people who came on shore on D-Day were actually British and Canadian. I'm putting the Canadians and the British together. That, of course, the dynamic changed very rapidly after, the supplies were brought to the Normandy coast. In any case, there were some very big strategic shifts along the way, including the decision finally to give the appearances of liberating Paris, even though Eisenhower stood back, held his ego in, and let Charles de Gaulle liberate his own people, which turned out to be really a magnificent decision. And also there were changes made the British wanted to change one of those decisions, and I could get into more and more detail. But one of the things that struck me was how, for the number of people involved, how remarkably agile this operation, the operation being the Allied command, really was. And I think at the end of the day, I know my grandfather, because he spoke of it often, was so proud of what the British and our other allies and the United States together had accomplished, because we had done it as a team. And it actually had never been done in warfare before, to have an integrated, a nationally integrated command, along with the integrated command of the Army, Navy, and Air Force. And so maybe I should just leave the question there, but thank you, Mr. Roosevelt, for the wonderful question, with great respect to your entire family.
The next question asks, what inspired your grandfather to propose that the language "In God We Trust" be added to the Pledge of Allegiance?
Oh, that's interesting. I didn't cover that actually in my book, but he did a couple of other things too that had never been done before. He, in his inaugural address, he started with a prayer, and he also, after his inaugural address, or after he was inaugurated, he gave my grandmother a kiss, which I think was really wonderful. Nobody had ever done that before publicly, and you know, she was such a teammate of his. The "In God We Trust" and a prayer at the beginning of his speech is interesting, because Eisenhower himself did not even know what, hadn't even chosen a religious denomination until after he was elected president for the first time. He did not like to see religion ever politicized. But like in other things he did in trying to bring people together, like getting everyone to agree that rule of law is a central tenet of our democracy, he could get people who didn't agree on the issue at the outset. And if he could say, well, this is a matter of rule of law, then people would begin to say, okay, it is a principle of that. How do we move forward? And so I think that the references to the God is, in a way, a reference to a cause bigger than ourselves, to a, it is a way of thinking about where your place is in the world. And I have to say that Ike had an extraordinarily humble sense about where he was in the hierarchy of the big scheme of things. And he writes about this many times during the war, and he had what I would sort of call an optimistic fatalism about him. The fatalism being that if his decision is incorrect, he takes full and complete responsibility, but also that this higher cause means that he too is dispensable. He used to tell me all the time as a kid, there's no indispensable person. Don't ever forget that. The cause is always more important. And so I'm sure that "In God We Trust" was his way of trying to elevate everyone to understand where our place is in this big scheme of things.
Excellent. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
The next question. How would you describe your grandfather's view of the civil rights movement? Apart from Little Rock, President Eisenhower did little to further that cause and was in no way a champion of the movement. For example, he played a very minor role in the passage of the 1957 Civil Rights Act. Did he feel that to do so would risk both energy and support which he needed for foreign policy, which was clearly his top priority?
Well, I think I would probably challenge that thesis. In my book, I call the chapter on civil rights "Establishing a Beachhead." Now, we have to remember that Eisenhower is a general, and he thinks like a general. Even when he's president, he thinks like a general. So he would be thinking all the time about resources, timelines, but primarily what he controls. Now, I mean, you see this time and time again in military strategy. You know, what do you control? What does the enemy control? And can you change that that dynamic or that percentage in any way? What are the assets you have at your disposal, or the liabilities? So in this, civil rights, Eisenhower understood the most he would ever have is between 4 and 8 years. And he says in 1953, in his first State of the Union address, that he fully intends to desegregate everything the federal government has control over, because he knew he controlled the federal government. So a lot of people, I think, would be surprised by that chapter to learn that not only did he desegregate certain units during World War II, which was as far as he could go because it was not Army policy to do that, secondly, understanding that he had just a short time between that speech and Brown versus Board of Education in 1954, Eisenhower desegregated Washington, D.C. and Washington, D.C. schools. He also took up the work of Harry Truman and actually did the major part of the job in desegregating the military, and he was in a great position to do that with, you know, formerly five stars on his shoulder. Then he desegregated government contracting, appointed judges who were not segregationists. I mean, that was a pretty tough test that the Attorney General assured the president he would follow up on, including the appointment of Earl Warren. And then the 1957, of course, the 57 legislation is complicated by the fact that most of the segregationists were Democrats, and the Democrats controlled both houses of Congress. Now, that's not to say Eisenhower was, some people were critical of him for signing the 1957 bill, but you know, it was drafted in the White House. But to the credit of Lyndon Johnson, and I must say that I have such warm feelings for him. I was fortunate enough to meet him on a number of occasions. And he and Ike really managed to cooperate. It was very clear that Democratic forces were not going to allow the voting rights section of the 57 legislation to appear in the 57 legislation. But steps were made, and let's not underestimate how tough that was. It was the first civil rights legislation since Reconstruction that passed Congress. So I think without the other measures he took to desegregate federal contracting and you know, all the other things he did, his you might misunderstand that it didn't look like much, but it's a different style of leadership. A lot of it done behind the scenes, but he always believed in forward progress. It's, again, if you're a military person, you got to be moving all the time, and you may not be able to get in a tank and take your men halfway across Europe in no time at all, as George Patton did at one stage, but continual progress, and that's what wins the wars. So thank you very much to your listener. And I hope you buy the book, and you know, I hope that I've added something to your thinking, and if not, drop me a line.
I would like to add that I remember in college, our professors would point with great pride how your grandfather elected to enforce the law of the land in Little Rock against the public tide. He thought that the law of the land needed to be enforced.
Right. Well, you see, I think he's misunderstood for his leadership in this respect, because he didn't get up, and it's true, he didn't get up and moralize with the public. That was sort of not his style. In order to make progress, because Congress was in the hands of both the House and the Senate, in the hands of Democrats, the segregationists were largely part of that party at that time. You know, he had to work in a way that would inspire their cooperation with him. And I think it's remarkable what he got done. His federal judgeships, by the way, played an enormous role in this, the South later. John Minor Wisdom and Frank Johnson and so many of these other great judges were Eisenhower appointees. Now, having said that, that is not to say that contributions weren't made in all areas. As a matter of fact, the listener might be very interested to know, and I was really very moved by this, is that Eisenhower administration then passes the 1960 bill, signs it into law, but never got the voting rights piece that he had wanted. And when Kennedy introduced the bill, Eisenhower told Kennedy on the telephone, this is well documented, Eisenhower agreed to pick up the phone and pressure fellow Republicans to support John Kennedy's legislation. Then, of course, the president tragically died. And Eisenhower went as far at that stage to tell Barry Goldwater that if Barry Goldwater didn't support this civil rights legislation, that he would vote for Lyndon Johnson. So even when he didn't have to be present for the debate, he used the authority he had as a former president to press his colleagues on this issue.
The next question, what were your grandfather's feelings about the war in Europe before Pearl Harbor?
I don't know the answer to that question. Of course, he was very concerned that this was going to end up being a world war. And Fox Connor, General Connor, who I mentioned earlier, when Ike, his protege, was with him in the Panama Canal Zone in the 1920s, General Connor was already pretty sure that we were moving towards war. I mean, as early as that, he thought that, the Versailles Treaty left so many things unresolved that there was a real danger that we were going to end up in a big military confrontation again. So I'm sure that Eisenhower was preparing himself. I know he was. He was came back from the Philippines and went to, he went to again another training fort and worked very, very hard. I'm having a senior moment here, the one up outside of Seattle, Washington. And in any case, he was working very hard to get ready for this war that he anticipated. He was offered, by the way, a job in the 1930s during the Depression to be a professional writer. And later he was offered another job in the Philippines, but he always knew that his role, that his duty lay with the Army, and that sooner or later, the situation was unsustainable and would probably reach the kind of level it did.
Can you talk about the President General Eisenhower's relationship with Churchill?
It's a remarkable relationship. I have to say that the two of, Winston Churchill is such a remarkable man and completely, it sort of fills me up when I think about it, because there's so much to say on the subject. I mean, during the war, they had a remarkably candid and frank relationship. And I think this created a lot of mutual respect between the two of them. There's a wonderful moment after the invasion of Normandy. The Allies had promised Stalin not only that we were going to open a second front, but we were going to open another mini front down in southern France to augment the troops who were coming on, coming into the Normandy campaign. And Winston Churchill didn't like it very much. And in a heated moment with Eisenhower, he threatened to quit as prime minister. So the next day, Eisenhower had a letter on Churchill's desk about the conversation the day before, and lamented the fact that they had both become rather exercised on the subject of whether Operation Anvil was going to go forward. And then Ike says, in this final personal moment, he says, I want you to know how much I've come to depend on you for support. And there were some very human, endearing touches at the end that obviously flagged the kind of relationship they had with each other. And Ike had told him in that conversation, if it's a political decision, talk to the president. If it's a military decision, this operation's going to go on. Anyway, Winston Churchill stood back from resigning, and their relationship snapped back into its never-ending warmth. I think it's really cute that they were both painters, because please Google Eisenhower's painting of Churchill on the internet. You will find a remarkable painting that Ike did of Churchill, But Churchill was the serious painter. Ike just painted to give these paintings away to his friends. And then I just have to say that for as much of an odd life one has had, that would be me, I did have some wonderful things that happened to me, including being able to meet Winston Churchill myself in 1959. And I don't know where I got this idea, but I had the audacity to paint a painting for Prime Minister Churchill of me and my horse or something absolutely ridiculous. And I don't know, it got delivered to the Prime Minister, and one of my prized possessions is Winston Churchill's thank you note about how I hope you continue painting, you know, throughout the years, and about what enjoyment it'll bring to you. I have to tell you, I can't make a round ball look like a round ball. That's how poor I am at that. But there was something very endearing about that, and they were friends, you know, until the very end. You remember Ike's eulogy at Churchill's funeral, you know, remember, goodbye, old friend. Wow.
What insight can you offer into your grandfather's handling of the U-2 spy incident and the resulting failed summit?
Right. Well, I mean, this is, you know, so my book is not full of sunshine and light all the time. No, the U-2 incident was a setback and something that Ike regretted, and something that made him very angry because he had been made a number of undertakings by the CIA. And it turns out that he Eisenhower was misled by a number of things the CIA said would happen. Number one, that the U-2, this aerial reconnaissance aircraft that had been developed in his administration to determine whether or not the Soviet Union was preparing for war or a surprise nuclear attack. And by the way, we offered the same opportunity to the Soviet Union to overfly our territory. So you might call this a unilateral open skies. Nevertheless, they were going into a summit, an important summit in Paris, and there were a lot of big issues to discuss, including the Berlin ultimatum and other issues. And Ike authorized on, he was given a number of openings for flying the aircraft one more time to determine the state of the Soviet Union's military capabilities for negotiating purposes. And Eisenhower authorized that. It was on May 1st, and the plane was shot down. It's kind of interesting. The Soviet Union knew that we were overflying their territory all along. So in my book, I offer some explanations for why the Soviet Union might have, excuse me, chosen to shoot that plane down on that occasion and not earlier. Nevertheless, the Paris summit collapsed. And certainly no major undertaking was made after that before Ike left office, because this is May of 1960, and the election was later that year. So, you know, he made his mistakes. He didn't have enough time to remind the public that he only made certain kinds of mistakes once, because he was a fast learner. But you know, I think he was always very angry with the CIA about that. As a matter of fact, General Goodpaster, one of Ike's closest associates, who was one of my mentors, told me that, and it's been reiterated in a book of scholarship, that Ike said he never wanted to be alone in the same room with the CIA again, or under any circumstances, that there'd have to be note takers, and so that we'd be very clear about the basis on which he was making certain decisions. Let me just add one final note here. Ike never really gained control over the CIA. I mean, they were an independent institution, I mean, practically at their founding. And this was always a great difficulty for presidents. But he was the one that, you know, saw the early years of that organization. And so there we are. I mean, he reorganized a lot of things in the government and managed to pass one executive order on the structure of the CIA, but time was short. and there isn't much more you can do than what you can do in between 4 and 8 years.
I might follow up that what I read was that General Eisenhower was very reluctant on that last mission, and it said it, every instinct in his soul said, don't do it. But the CIA was so convincing.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. And that, see, now knowing, and this is where I can add a little something to the public discourse. I knew Ike. I mean, sometimes I call him Ike. I don't know, it's crazy. Granddad. I like to use a more formal ways when I'm referring to his public career, as I said earlier. But he wasn't as angry with the CIA as he was with himself, because he something didn't feel right to him. But on the other hand, Khrushchev had already demonstrated that he, you know, was an irascible, over-exaggerator. Khrushchev had watched the debate going on in our country about the missile gap and, you know, Sputnik and all this, and understood that, the you know, he could get away with bluster and people would believe him. And Ike didn't believe him. He'd worked with the Soviet Union during World War II. I think he had a pretty good handle on the Russian mentality. And so there was something inside him that said, this isn't a good idea. But he was assured that the plane would never survive, nor would the pilot. And that, while that may sound cold-hearted to civilians, I mean, this was a military man, and he was on a military mission. So, you know, you have to put that down to clearly a mistake. But a lot of progress had been made with the Soviet Union, too. They'd come on that 10-day trip to the United States Khrushchev had. Actually, I had the remarkable opportunity to meet Nikita Khrushchev, too, during that time, because Eisenhower and Khrushchev were not able to reach an agreement on Berlin. And so Granddad brought the Soviet premier down to the farm, and we were assigned, us kids, to be very well behaved. But to do a lot of smiling and remind, I mean, I later say that the grandchildren strategy, which was deployed more than once, was there to send a subliminal message that I have grandchildren and you have grandchildren, and we better figure this out, because their future is at stake. So I played that little minor role from time to time. that being one of the more memorable ones, I can say.
British General Montgomery demonstrated lack of aggressiveness in Africa, eastern southern Italy, and capturing Caen, France during the Normandy invasion. Why would General Eisenhower agree to Montgomery's foolhardy plan of Operation Market Garden?
Well, you know, the alliance was an extremely complicated one, and while Montgomery and Eisenhower may have disagreed about a lot of things, in fact, Montgomery had extraordinary support from the British sector of the British part of COSAC. Remember, I said that they had operational oversight for the they were the board of directors, which would be my analogy. And so, you know, that I think Eisenhower finally, they were struggling over this, spearhead into, you know, the heart of Germany versus a broad front. And I think this was, you know, a way to have Montgomery fight a battle here and see if he was right about that issue. What made the alliance so successful is that we were giving each other lots and lots of pushback, and it kept the alliance together. You know, we were not able to completely, no one side was able to completely dominate the other with its view. I would add, if this isn't if we haven't run out of time here, that Eisenhower must not have found it too cumbersome to have lots and lots of pushback during the war, because he designed his cabinet for lots and lots of pushback during his presidency. And it's interesting that he liked to have all of these voices that had differing opinions, because it would help him understand how important it is to have your own assumptions challenged, so that you can get, you know, a more wholesome more nuanced view of all of the factors and any complicated a set of issues.
That was one of the greatest exhibitions of his leadership.
Being able to get the pushback
and challenge assumptions.
No, he wanted to challenge his own assumptions too. He didn't believe that all the thinking resided in the mind of one man. That one man. This is where people are in the military or who are governors, for instance, are very different kinds of leaders often than people who have been legislators, because legislators tend to be, singular individuals who organize their staffs in certain ways to elevate the singular thinking of a senator or a representative, whereas governors have to organize, their administrations for working with a larger set of people and issues, and it's just a slightly different skill set. We need them all, but there are just some differences.
Final two comments. Question. The night that your grandfather died on March the 22nd, I asked my father what he remembered about. He always called him the general. He never called him the president. I said, what do you remember about him? And he said, one is, I don't know if this is true or not. That was my father talking. That the French had petitioned the United States to borrow, I don't know how you can borrow it, but a nuclear weapon in Dien Diem Phu in Laos in 1954. And Eisenhower said, no, we're not going to start a nuclear war. And any comment on that? And then the second question, I remember my father saying that he will always remember the general brought dignity to America.
Oh, well, that's very nice. That's very nice of your father to say. But, I think he inspired people to be better than they could be. And America was trying hard in those years to modernize and to be able to find ways forward to underscore the promise of our country to people from all sectors of life in our country. You would be interested in how many times in all of his speeches he talks about all races, colors, and creeds. He's always mentioning that this is the great aspiration that we make access to opportunity possible. And I think it was a very tumultuous time on the international scene and even domestically. But I do, he was a dignified man, I will say that. As far as nuclear weapons in France, first of all, I would have to refer you to a real expert on this subject in Arthur Larson's book, Eisenhower, the President No One Knew. He talks about also the subject later about whether or not Johnson should use nuclear weapons in Vietnam, and Larson says he never said that, and he didn't believe it. I will say a couple of things very strongly. As Eisenhower did not believe in small wars. He thought small wars got larger, and then they got larger, that the other side, the losing side, would always use whatever weapons they have in their arsenal. That's what he saw Hitler do, and he was pretty convinced that that's part of the psychology of war. The problem with that is, of course, is that in the hydrogen bomb era, the last weapon in your arsenal is one that had the capacity, to obliterate much, if not all, of the world. And so he was very skeptical, about nuclear weapons. And the big debate always occurred, would Eisenhower have ever used them? Because certainly there were hints that he might. And my own feeling, simply because I knew General Goodpaster and most of his closest associates, that he would have never used them. But it was his credibility as a wartime leader was such that if he said, all options are on the table, people would know that he would mean that, because he had such a, because of his leadership during the war. So Anyway, it's a complex subject, but a really fascinating one.
Well, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I'm going to stay on with you just a second or so, but we're going to say goodbye to our virtual audience. And we're so honored, Dallin Public Library is so honored to have Susan Eisenhower, the author of the book, How Ike Led.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Keener. It's been a real pleasure, and I want to thank everyone for being with us this evening.